The Lord be with you.
And with
you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. The people were filled with expectation, and all were asking in their hearts whether John might be the Christ. John answered them all, saying, "I am baptizing you with water, but one mightier than I is coming. I am not worthy to loosen the thongs of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire." After all the people had been baptized, and Jesus also had been baptized and was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in a bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." The Gospel of the Lord.
In our first reading this morning from the book of the prophet Isaiah, we hear how the Lord has chosen him. We hear this language used of being chosen and set apart and having a purpose in life, having a purpose to prepare, literally, the way of the Lord. This is the whole prophet Isaiah's entire mission. To prepare the way of the Lord. More than any other prophet, the prophet Isaiah talks and prepares for the Messiah, for Jesus Christ. This is long before he's even born, close to 400 years before Jesus is even born. The prophet Isaiah is preparing the way for the Lord. And is using this language of "I have set you aside and I have put you in a place of honor." And I think a lot of times, as Catholics, as Christians, we get into this thinking of, "Oh, well, good for you. I'm glad you're set and you have to do that," right? We leave it to the other guy. "I sure am glad God called Father and not me to do all of that." No. Actually, this reading is reminding us that through our baptism, we too have a prophetic call. We too are called to prepare the way of the Lord. We too are set apart, a chosen people. Before we were formed in our mother's womb, God knew us and had a plan for us. In fact, he had it planned that you would attend 11 a.m. Mass on Sunday, January 13th, 2019. He knew that. He planned that. He planned for me to preach this homily to you. It's all God. It's all Jesus. But I think we have a tendency to blow it off and say it's that person's job, it's their job. But no. Let me remind you, the day that you were baptized, the priest baptized you, and after your baptism, you were anointed. And that anointing goes something like this, with give or take a word or two, I might have it a little off. But it says, "As Jesus was anointed as priest, prophet, and king, may you live also as a priest, a prophet, and a king." You have been anointed a priest, a prophet, and a king. You have this same anointing as Jesus Christ, and this is called the priesthood of the baptized, that each and every one of us is invited into through baptism. Now, of course, there is a ministerial priesthood, which is what priests are called to. There is a ministerial diaconate, the deacon is called to. But in a very particular way, all of us are invited into that priesthood of Jesus Christ through our baptism. But not just his priesthood, but also his prophetic role and his royalty. So you and I are invited into this prophetic role, which means everything said about the prophet Isaiah in the first reading today, yeah, you got it. It's you and the prophet. It's me and the prophet. All of us are called into that prophetic role to prepare the way of the Lord, to take use of those baptismal graces that were given to us through the baptismal water. There's those sacred waters that Jesus made sacred, right? Because Jesus didn't need baptism. He's the only begotten Son of God. But he went through those baptismal waters in order to sanctify them so that they might be holy for us. We hear that throughout all of creation, water is used as a means of cleansing and sanctifying and purifying and preparing. And in a very powerful way, through baptism, we're invited into that. So you and I are the modern-day prophets. You and I are the ones who continue to spread the message of Jesus Christ in our day and age today. This is exactly where St. Paul, in the second reading today, is really going. He's talking about, I believe, God shows no partiality. What does that mean? It means that God loves us the same. It doesn't mean that God has more love for me because I am a priest of His church. It means that His love is so perfect and so awesome that He can love you and I exactly the same in the same moment. And His love for us is unique in particular. What do I mean by that? I mean that by whatever state in life you're in, God loves you there. It doesn't mean that God loves His priests more than He loves anybody else. He loves His bishops more than anybody else, or even Pope Francis more than anybody else. It means that His love is unique and particular to each and every one of us in our own state of life. And His love is not any less for anyone. That's why His love is called perfect. He shows no partiality because His love is perfect and total and complete for each and every one of us. And it is particular because God knows our needs. God knows exactly where to love us, right? God knows exactly where it hurts and where to pour more love into in order to conquer that darkness, in order to that the life of baptism might spring anew from within us. This is why St. Paul says, God shows no partiality because His love is the same. If His love were different for other people, it wouldn't be perfect love. If it was more love over here and less love over here, that would not be perfect. Perfect love is the same and total for every single one of His baptized adopted sons and daughters. That's you and I. This feast of the baptism of the Lord Jesus Christ reminds us of this call. It reminds us not only that we are baptized into, as a priest, prophet, and a king, but it reminds us of God's love for us. And as the dove comes down onto Jesus in the form, in bodily form, it says, and He says, "This is My beloved Son with whom I am well pleased, that is you and I as well." But we have such a hard time realizing that. And that's why I preach about it so often. Because we have to get it into our heads that God is pleased with us. I think for so long, maybe in the church and in the world, we get into this idea of thinking that God is mad at me. God doesn't like me because I'm a sinner. God's so upset with me because I'm living my life this way. It might not be the way God wants you to live your life, but God is pleased with you. That God delights in you. And just you in His presence, just you here in this church today, makes Him happy. He delights in you. He is pleased with the efforts that you are making to live a good Christian life. That makes God happy. So as God says this about His beloved Son, Jesus Christ, and Jesus opens those baptismal waters to incorporate us into this family, you and I are God's beloved. You and I are brought into this family, into this union with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, completely and totally present at this baptism of Jesus Christ. And God says to you and to me, I am pleased with you. I delight in you. I love you. I call you to this prophetic life, to this holy life. In God's eyes, we are royalty. We are kings and queens through baptism because we are incorporated into that holy family of Jesus Christ. That's what our in our Eucharistic prayer, do you ever hear the word co-heirs? We usually don't hear the word heirs anymore because heirs to what? To a throne. But we are made co-heirs in the throne of Jesus Christ. We are made co-heirs in His divinity, in His royalty. So this feast reminds us of our goodness. It reminds us of what baptism does to us. It does all of these great things, our prophetic call, our priestly call, our royal call, our reminder of how much God loves us, and our reminder that God delights in us. And He is pleased with us in even our simple or feeble efforts to please Him, to do as He commanded us to do. Even though we slip and fall from time to time, He never stops loving, because that's what God does. And that's what He does best, is He loves. And He regenerates and recreates in us through the baptismal waters the same kind of creation, the same kind of love, the same kind of power that was at the beginning of time when He created the world, when He created Adam and Eve. He recreates us anew through baptism, and each time we dip our fingers into the font, each time we bless ourselves when we come into the church, we should be reminded that we are beloved sons and daughters of God. If you'd please stand with me, we will renew our baptismal promises in place of the creed today. It is an option to renew our baptism.